Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Opium War by Brian Inglis, narrated by Nigel Patterson. The Life and Work of Brian Inglis, an assessment by Neil Inglis. The life and career of Irish author Brian Inglis brought him many accolades for his achievements in journalism and broadcasting. His editorship of The Spectator was notable for his nurturance of new talent and the resulting boom in the magazine's circulation. On television, he was a pioneer on What the Papers Say, starting in 1956, and he went into battle with primitive vote-tallying computers during the Rochdale by-election in 1958. In 1962, Brian took over the reins of All Our Yesterdays, the long-running Granada documentary series that reviewed the events of a quarter century in the past, reaching its glory days in the period 1964-70, when it covered the World War II years. Henry Fairley is sometimes credited with coining the term the establishment in the pages of The Spectator, and Inglis was in many ways a quintessential establishment figure. Yet Brian chafed against such respectability. His investigation of unorthodox healing, fringe medicine, was considered so controversial that the publisher included a preface by a well-regarded surgeon to reassure anxious readers. On The Spectator, Brian brought in younger writers, often on the political left, Alan Bryan, Bernard Levin. Yet in so doing, he deliberately overlooked the magazine's historic ties with the Tory party, an affiliation never forgotten by the magazine's proprietor. Inglis's resignation, soothed by the prospect of a top job in TV, soon followed. Inglis's generous contract with Granada Television allowed him to pursue his own intellectual interests, and when All Our Yesterdays came to an end in 1973, Inglis was not sorry to return to full-time writing. Why? As the host of a top-rated World War II documentary in the 1960s, Inglis was never free to speak his mind. On camera, he was sharing his insights with millions of armchair historians all over the country, for whom the war was a recent and vividly remembered experience. This was neither the time nor the place to shock mainstream audiences with awkward revelations. Inglis could not have mentioned the Ultra Enigma programmes, were he aware of their existence. One day, Brian vowed to slough off these restrictions. A return to freelance status would allow him to be a revisionist historian. The Story of Ireland and The Forbidden Game, A Social History of Drugs, are witty, densely researched and highly readable in Inglis's trademark economical style, in which every sentence and every phrase have something important to say. A different aspect of his personality, a disturbing asperity, is evident in The Opium War, which dates from the same period as The Forbidden Game, and was palpably inspired by Inglis's researches in connection with the latter title. The Opium War is an epic work that resonates to this day, and some effort must be made to understand the author's motivations in pursuing this project. Moreover, this is the publication regarding which the Inglis estate fields the most queries. Inglis regarded the opium trade as an abomination, yet, as we have observed, he did not object to drug use per se or on moral grounds. What then were the roots of Brian's anger? The Opium War, 1976. The story begins in India, a country where Brian spent his early years. His father, Sir Claude Inglis, was a well-regarded hydraulic engineer stationed in Pune and other areas. Inglis Sr. never regarded or treated Irish Catholics or Indians as inferiors. Opium grown under conditions of great horror was harvested, packed and shipped to China with twofold aims: to maximise the flow of revenue to British coffers and to ensure as much plausible deniability as possible for the Crown. Imagine Inglis as a prosecutor building a case against the British establishment. Inglis's excoriation of this opium policy is warranted, yet a listener may wish to call for a cross-examination. What exactly was the author's own agenda in this matter? Brian's treatment of capitalism and foreign trade is bleak and Dickensian. This is a world of chimney sweeps and child labour, of landlordism and rack-renting, of official rapacity and corruption. Missing from Inglis's account is any sense of the self-correcting capacity of British-style capitalism and the powerful impulses for reform it could and did engender. One thinks of the Quakers and abolitionism. Likewise absent from the Opium War are any references to the many wonderful advances in science and technology in the 1700s and 1800s, which made human life so much better and more bearable. Clean water, communications, and electricity, to name a few. In fact, the reference to electricity provides us with an important clue to Inglis's motivations. Inglis had no time for the Victorian pioneers of science and technology, such as Michael Faraday, because they were too closely identified with efforts to suppress and ridicule Victorian spiritualism, a topic dear to Brian's heart, and covered in exhaustive detail in Natural and Supernatural, and its sequel Science and Parascience. Inglis viewed the paranormal as the single most important underreported story of his own time. His investigations into psi forces earned him mockery from contemporary sceptics, and he fought fire with fire, shaming his critics in the process. For Inglis, those Victorian rationalists who had mocked the occult, Faraday and Darwin among them, were cut from the same cloth as the Whitehall mandarins who rationalised imperial foreign policy. Watch out for Brian's use of the word suspect in describing both types of men, a classic Inglisism, denoting reprehensible behaviour. If one returns to the Opium War, one might argue that the British expedition to punish the Chinese authorities was an empire's predictable response to a perceived affront. The real surprise would be if London had done nothing. The British action may not have been pretty, it may not have been ethical, decent, or wise, but it was in keeping with the behaviour of imperial armies throughout history. The saga of the Chinese opium racket and its tragic outcome represented a case study in commodity trade and frontier economics in an era of limited communications and obsessive official secrecy. This was the kind of case study, unflattering to Great Britain, that was calculated to appeal to a left-leaning economics lecturer in Ireland in the immediate post-war era, and Brian was employed in such a capacity while studying for his PhD at Trinity College Dublin. In fairness, Brian was never a Marxist. He would have had patience for the modern-day practitioners of victimology, and he was always too good a scholar and too widely read to tolerate intellectual laziness. He would be the first to admit that the world in the century of his birth had changed irrevocably. For countries that once laboured under the imperial yoke, India, Ireland, and China, have put the past behind them and enjoyed massive booms. In this, Brian would have found much cause for optimism. Introduction. It has happened to me before, and I trust it will again, that the research for one book has lured me to write another. Preparing to investigate the history of drugs for The Forbidden Game, I happened to pick up the 1840 China Papers dealing with the events leading up to the Opium War, which must surely be one of the most compulsively readable collections of documents ever published as a parliamentary blue book. From that, I went on to read some of the authors who have covered the same ground, from contemporaries like Thomas de Quincey and Samuel Warren, down to recent writers, Maurice Collis, Arthur Whaley, and Xinpao Chang. And one aspect of the subject began increasingly to interest me. What or who was the cause of the war? Not that there is ever a single cause, though there may be an accepted trigger event, like Sarajevo. In the case of the Opium War, however, the popular assumption has been that the chief cause, at least, is easily identifiable. As Thomas Arnold complained when he heard that an expeditionary force had been dispatched to China, it was to maintain smuggling. And worse, smuggling which consisted of the introduction of a demoralising drug which the government of China wished to keep out and which we, for lucre of gain, want to introduce by force, and in this quarrel are going to burn and slay in the pride of our supposed superiority. This view, however, has been challenged, not merely by defenders of the government's decision at the time and apologists for it since, but also, I was surprised to find, by most of the serious students of the period who have written about it during the past 50 years, beginning with David Owen in his diligently researched British Opium Policy in China and India, published in the United States in 1934. Only in the light of the immediate occasion, Owen concluded, can the conflict be called an opium war, a verdict soon to be echoed by Professor W.C. Costin, and more recently by Morris Collis and Edgar Holt. American historians of Chinese descent have tended to accept this view. In his Commissioner Lin and the Opium War, Xin Pao Chang surmised that though it arose over opium, it might just as easily have been the Molasses War, if molasses had happened to be the commodity which the British merchants had been determined to sell. And I see why Xu, in The Rise of Modern China, described opium as the immediate but not the ultimate cause of the war. To pursue this controversy in The Forbidden Game would have taken me too far from the book's main theme, and I have gone into it here instead. All wars have some of their roots far back in history, often in events or trends which at first sight have little or nothing to do with the eventual hostilities, and the Opium War is no exception. As it happens, too, the convoluted course which those earlier events took is more absorbing than the actual war itself, which was too one-sided to be of much interest even to military historians, and which, I feel, has been too often related to need repetition in any detail. I have followed current colloquial usage in the spelling of Indian and Chinese names and terms, or, where there is no generally accepted spelling, used the one which seems least likely to cause confusion. For example, the East India Company's Canton agents were usually described as supercargoes, but I have preferred, as some of them did, the term supracargo, which sounds less like a latter-day freightliner. For simplicity, too, I have used the term viceroy throughout when referring to the emperor's representatives in the provinces of China. There were also governors, but the functions and pronouncements of the two were not kept distinct, certainly not in the translations of their edicts. I have modernized old spelling and, where necessary for clarity, grammar and punctuation. One source of confusion, however, or at least of irritation, I have left: the frequent contemporary references to England or the English, by which was meant Britain or the British. Currency represents a problem. Opium transactions within India, where it was produced, were conducted in rupees, the opium trade in Spanish dollars, and the revenue derived from opium in sterling. This is less confusing than it might be, as the rates are easily memorized. £1 is equivalent to $5, which is equivalent to 10 rupees. The rupee, however, varied in value between 8 and 12 to the pound, and the Spanish dollar frequently had to be bought at a premium owing to its scarcity. The statistics, therefore, have to be regarded as approximations, but they were approximations anyway. Every statement regarding the quantities of opium consumed in China, the historian Hosea Ballou Morse complained 50 years ago, appears to differ from every other statement. Not surprisingly, in view of the fact the drug was contraband. Still, precision happens to be less important than trends, and the available figures, though they may be inexact for any particular year, are a safe enough general guide. Chapter 1. The China Investment, 1729-93. There must have been five stages in the development of man's appreciation of opium, the botanist George Watt surmised, in his monumental Dictionary of the Economic Products of India. The poppy would first have been admired as an attractive flower, then relished as a vegetable. It was still eaten in India as a salad, like lettuce, at the time he was writing, the 1890s. At some point, it must have been found that the juice of the poppy could be made into a refreshing beverage, and consumption of the juice would have led to the discovery of the potent nature of the inspissated sap. Only then would it have come to be taken as a drug. As a drug, Opium was taken for different purposes, travellers from Europe in the 16th and 17th centuries found, in different regions of India. In the Mughal Empire, it was regarded as an intoxicant, and as such reserved for the pleasure of the court and the aristocracy. Arriving in 1608 in the Hector, the first ship to visit India under the British flag, William Hawkins was well received, but not by the emperor, who he gathered was under the influence. In central India, however, it was in everyday use among all classes, the staple of the coolie and the courier, who ate or drank it in small quantities to provide them with the energy and endurance to carry them through the working day. Rajput warriors took it to calm their nerves before going into battle, so that it became associated with bravery. If a pledge were ratified between two men by eating opium together, it was considered inviolable under all circumstances. When the British East India Company secured trading rights from the Mughal Emperor early in the 17th century, its agents found that although he enforced a strict monopoly, the contractor who managed it for him was willing to sell them opium for export. A welcome concession, because the profit they could make on it helped to pay for the spices they needed from the East Indies. They had known it at home only as a sedative medicine. But in Sumatra, the agent in charge of a British trading station wrote in 1713, it produced very different effects on different constitutions. Some are laid by it into so profound a sleep that the noise of a drum, a cannon, or even a scolding woman cannot wake them. Others are reduced to a perfect state of indolence, insensible of pain and possessed with such a kind of negative pleasure as renders them regardless of everything. A third sort are downright delirious, sleep with their eyes wide open, and talk a great deal without any design or connection. Opium had the effect, invaluable for traders, of making hungry where most it satisfied. Those consumers who became addicted to it maintained a rate of demand which seemed proof against price increases. And among the countries where by this time a demand existed was China, as Daniel Defoe knew. Robinson Crusoe twice shipped opium there, because it bore a great price among the Chinese. The impression was to gain ground later that the Chinese must have taken opium from time immemorial, but Chinese scholars have found no reference to it earlier than the 8th century AD. The opium-bearing poppy was not indigenous there, and the American missionary and diplomat Samuel Wells Williams, whose The Middle Kingdom was to be the fullest and fairest of 19th century studies of China, came to the conclusion from his researches that for nearly 1,000 years, such imports of opium as there had been were for medical purposes. The Jesuit missionaries who were allowed into the country in the 17th century, he pointed out, did not mention it. They surely would have made some comment if they had encountered it. Opium came into use as a non-medical drug in China at some time towards the end of the century, in and around Canton, the port through which most foreign merchantmen traded. Their crews reported that it was smoked there, not eaten or drunk, as in India. How and where opium was first smoked remains a mystery, but the probability is that it had been tried out in the East Indies, mixed with tobacco, a method reported in use in Java in the 1680s, and introduced by Dutch traders, first to Formosa and later to the mainland. At some stage, a way was found to dispense with the tobacco. The opium, Wells Williams explained, was first seethed, simmered in water, and strained several times to remove impurities. The resultant paste was then rendered down to the consistency required, necessitating a loss of about half the original weight, but enabling the purchaser to judge if there had been adulteration. The smoking equipment consisted of a pipe made from a tube of heavy wood, the bowl at the end of it being designed not so much to hold opium like a tobacco pipe as to collect the dross. The smoker lay down on a couch, near enough to a lighted lamp to be able to bring the bowl close to the flame. A pellet of the size of a pea, being taken on the end of a spoon-headed needle, is put upon the hole of the bowl and set on fire at the lamp, and inhaled at one whiff, so that none of the smoke shall be lost. Old smokers will retain the breath a long time, filling the lungs and exhaling the fumes through the nose. When the pipe has burned out, the smoker lies listless for a moment while the fumes are dissipating, and then repeats the process until he has spent all his purchase or taken his prescribed dose. The effects were first to make the smoker loquacious and prone to break out into boisterous, silly merriment, then to send him to sleep, but sleep which, Wells Williams felt, gave no refreshment to the addict, only a craving for more. Reports of the spread of the opium-smoking habit eventually began to disturb the imperial court at Peking, and in 1729 an edict put a ban on its importation except under license for medical use. Heavy penalties were imposed for dealing in the drug. Offenders were to be sentenced to wear the kang, an outsized wooden collar worn like a portable pillory, and to receive up to 100 strokes of the bamboo. This was disturbing news for the East India Company's Canton agents, the supracargoes, so called from the time they had sailed with the company's ships as its commercial representatives. By this time, they had settled in Macau. If the company were detected importing the drug illegally, it would lose its trading rights in China. These rights had not been easily secured, because the earlier attitude of rather condescending benevolence, which visitors from the West had encountered when they first reached China in the Middle Ages, had changed to suspicion and hostility following the appearance of the Portuguese in the 16th century. Their commercial methods were not readily distinguishable from piracy, and when the first English ships reached China under Captain Weddell in 1637, they too were suspected of being pirates. As Weddell had resorted to force to overawe the local officials, he had confirmed the prevalent impression that the foreign devils, as they came to be popularly known, were not to be trusted. It had been difficult for the East India Company to live down this reputation, particularly as the Manchu emperors were even more worried about the spread of foreign influence in China than their Ming predecessors had been. But they were also chronically in need of revenue. Because the foreign merchants were prepared to buy Chinese tea and silk, they came to be tolerated, though control on their movements remained strict. They were allowed to settle in Macau, where the Portuguese had acquired squatters' rights, exercising much the same kind of limited authority that a town council today enjoys. And following the decline of Portugal as a maritime power, the East India Company had become commercially dominant there, with the help of a charter which gave it the monopoly of all British trade with the East. But the Emperor, the company supracargoes feared, would withdraw all facilities if he heard that they were defying his new ban on opium. They sent a warning to the company's Calcutta headquarters not to ship any further consignments. The recommendation was accepted and apparently observed, though doubtless small amounts continued to be smuggled in. The opium smokers of Canton had to rely on what they could get from the Portuguese through Macau, or on supplies landed by freebooters. Robert Clive. There matters might have rested indefinitely, with the company continuing to send only licensed consignments of opium to China, had it not been for an event which was to have a profound effect on the imperialist era. The Nawab of Bengal, Alawardi Khan, had retained control over foreign traders by keeping them commercially content and politically impotent in his domains, much the same policy as the Chinese emperors were following. But when he died in 1756, he was succeeded by Suraja Dowla, whose hatred for the East India Company and all it stood for prompted him to seize Fort William, the company's Calcutta headquarters. While he slept off a debauch, over 100 British subjects were locked up for the night in a 20-foot dungeon, the Black Hole of Calcutta, and by morning only 23 survived. The Europeans, Alawardi Khan had warned, are like a hive of bees, of whose honey you may reap the benefit, but if you disturb their hive, they will sting you to death. On the battlefield of Plassey in 1757, Robert Clive administered the sting which was to prove mortal not only to Suraja Dowla, but to the entire Mughal Empire. And it is at this point that the train of events which brought about the Opium War can be seen, by hindsight, to have begun. They began because the territory was so eminently plunderage. Although the great days of the empire had departed, Alawardi Khan had continued to enjoy a revenue which would have been the envy of most European monarchs. Of all the provinces which had been subject to the Mughals, Macaulay was to recollect, the wealthiest was Bengal. No part of India possessed such natural advantages, both for agriculture and for commerce. The Ganges, rushing through 100 channels to the sea, has formed a vast plain of rich mould, which, even under the tropical sky, rivals the verdure of an English April. The rice fields yield an increase such as is elsewhere unknown. Spices, sugar, vegetable oils are produced with marvellous exuberance. The tyranny of man had for ages struggled in vain against the overflowing bounty of nature. In spite of the Mussulman despot and the Maratha freebooter, Bengal was known throughout the East as the Garden of Eden. The East India Company, which owed much of its prosperity to this source of its trade, had every intention of holding on to it. But how could the necessary security be maintained? Clive was in no doubt that, as he told the chairman of the company's court of directors, Lawrence Sullivan, he could have appropriated the whole of the country to the company and preserved it afterwards. But the company, though its army had shown it was capable of such conquest, had no equivalent body of administrators capable of political consolidation, nor had it any desire to recruit them and pay them. The company, as Sullivan curtly reminded Clive, was a trading concern, in business for profit. Bengal was to remain independent under a puppet ruler. The consequences were disastrous. The Nawab might nominally be on the throne of his forefathers, but it was the company which had put him there, and alone could keep him there. And this offered the company's servants, as they styled themselves, an unprecedented opportunity, which they seized the moment Clive returned to England in 1760. They were traders. The great majority of them had only one ambition, to make their fortunes as quickly as possible, the high mortality rate in the East being an additional inducement, before returning to England to buy seats in the country, and, if possible, in Parliament. They had no stake in Bengal's future. On the contrary, funds diverted from their pockets into investment would be wasted. The man who showed them the way was a young Dutch adventurer who had emigrated to England and then joined the company, William Bolts. With some colleagues, he undertook to provide the revenue the company required to pay its expenses in Bengal, in return for what amounted to a free hand for his group in raising it there, an offer which was welcomed by the company's management in Calcutta. The method Bolt's group used to raise it, and to enrich themselves in the process, was simple but ingenious. Under the Mughals, the company had enjoyed the privilege of distributing its imports and exports without having to pay the transit charges imposed by local rulers. Bolt's group now claimed that this right extended to all produce, including the manufactures, the corn, and even the vegetables of Bengal. As a result, the group was able to offer higher prices for local products than the Bengal merchants, who had to pay the local taxes, yet sell them more cheaply. And by this means the merchants were quickly forced out of business. The group then used the virtual monopoly it had acquired of the entire marketing system to compel producers to accept lower prices and to compel consumers to pay more, the company's sepoys being called in to persuade anybody who raised objections. The Nawab protested at the way Bolt's agents plunder the people, injure and disgrace my servants, and some of the servants of the company, shocked at what was being done in its name, added their protests, including Sergeant Brego, in charge of a detachment of the company's sepoys. Called upon to enforce the local agent's decisions, if anybody refused to accept them, he told the council in Calcutta, a flogging or confinement immediately ensues. But when he tried to intervene, pointing out to the agents that his orders were to see that justice was done, he received menacing notes saying that he would live to regret it. This, he explained, was why he was writing to the authorities. If he was informed against, as had been threatened, he hoped they would realise why. Henry Van Sittert, who had taken Clive's place, did realise why, but he was powerless. It was Colonel Clive's good fortune, he remarked, to leave India before the company's treasure was totally exhausted. There were no funds at his disposal, and most of his colleagues were too busy following Bolt's example to heed his pleas for moderation. Their depredations roused hatred against them, leading in 1763 to a dispute in Patna, which culminated in the savage massacre of all the 200 British subjects in the town. Although Patna was the centre of the opium industry, opium probably had little responsibility for the crisis. It was not in common use locally, Indian hemp drugs being preferred, and the fact it was primarily bought for export by the company had protected the Nawab's monopoly. But the industry was to be profoundly affected by what followed. Although Patna was soon reoccupied by the company's forces and the Nawab deposed, there could be no question of putting up and propping up another puppet ruler. Clive had to be asked to return, with what amounted to full authority to take over the Nawab's powers and rights, including the opium monopoly. Clive immediately realised the reason for the collapse of the Bengal administration. In his time, as he was to explain, the company had not been allowed to carry on trade within Bengal, let alone trade free of duty. What the company was not allowed to do, its servants clearly had no right to do, and the absurdity of a system so ruinous to the natives and so prejudicial to the revenues of the country was obvious. As he had been given plenary powers, he could bring the spoliation to an end. But to effect reforms, he needed administrators, and if they were not to be corrupted by the pursuit of riches, they would have to be salaried. Where was the money to come from? This rich and flourishing kingdom, as Clive himself had described it after Plassey, had been reduced in less than a decade to near penury. Only a few commodities remained which could safely be taxed, salt, tobacco, and betel, because the consumers' dependence upon them ensured that they would continue to be bought in Bengal, even if duties increased the price, and opium, because of its established export market. A land tax, it was decided, and duties on salt, tobacco, and betel would provide the revenue to pay for the new administration. To restore some of the profits which had vanished after Plassey, the company's agents would have to look to opium. The Patna Group. The source of a war, like the source of a river, may turn out to be not some well-defined spring, but a patch of marshland. The Opium War had its origins in the malodorous swamp which Bolts and his crew left in Bengal. Thereafter, the flow of events leading to the conflict can be mapped, because opium, for so long only one of the company's many trading interests, became progressively more essential to its prospects and even to its survival. The initial step, and one which to a great extent determined the future, was the transfer of the Nawab's monopoly to a group within the company. Now the company had the monopoly, and could dictate its own price to competitors, or refuse to allow them to trade in opium at all. Because the opium made from the poppies cultivated in the Bihar region around Patna was more highly esteemed, especially for smoking, than any other, this amounted to making opium an export as well as an internal monopoly, and the Patna Group, as it came to be called, began to look around for more customers. China, with its estimated 300 million inhabitants, was the obvious market. But the company supercargoes there were still adamant in their refusal to have anything to do with contraband. There was, however, another way to ship it to China without involving them. Although the company held jealously to its monopoly of trade between Britain, India, and the East, it permitted what were described as country ships to operate under its license. They were useful because they were prepared to take goods on speculative trading voyages, and they were tolerated much as charter companies may be tolerated by a national airline, so long as it can control their competition. How and where they disposed of their goods was no concern of the companies, as technically the goods ceased to belong to it the moment they were bought and shipped. More opium, therefore, could be produced for sale to the Parsi merchants in Calcutta and dispatched by them in country ships to Macau without embarrassing the Canton supercargoes. In 1767, when Clive left India for the last time, Ironically, he had himself become an addict. His death, 7 years later, was attributed by his family to the effects of an overdose of laudanum. Over 100,000 pounds of opium was brought to Macau illicitly by this means. The Patna Group had some uneasy moments before it established its monopolistic hold. The Dutch did not see why they should pay the inflated prices they were now being charged, nor did the Parsi merchants and the country shipowners, who wanted a larger share of the profits, and they made their grievance known in London. The Court of Directors were aware of the growing strength of the free trade movement, soon to find expression in the Wealth of Nations, and they realised that what the Patna Group was doing would expose them to criticism and perhaps legislative intervention to revoke their charter. In 1769, they issued instructions that the channels of trade should be in every respect free and unconstrained, opium being one of the commodities referred to, because any constraint was contrary to the fundamental principles of trade. But the members of the council which Clive had set up in Calcutta knew what to do now that he was safely out of the way. Although they could not openly reject the court's ruling, they could negate it for the benefit of their Patna Group by means of an innocent-sounding qualification. Trade in opium was to be free, subject only to such restrictions as the ministers and officers of the company may think proper to impose for the benefit of the company and the public. It would be for the benefit of the company and the public, the council decided, that opium production should continue to be controlled, and the control was left in the hands of the group. In theory, free trade had been established for all commodities. In practice, opium remained a tight monopoly. The system of a monopoly within the monopoly, though, could not be expected to last. The members of the group probably neither expected it to last nor cared whether it did or not. Most of them were busy, like their predecessors, trying to extract what they could from Bengal before they sailed for home. To the alarm of Harry Verelst, who became president of the council in 1769. Finding himself powerless to interfere in the commercial activities of members of the company, he sent a warning to Leadenhall Street that the prodigious ancient riches of the Mughal Empire, which had initially attracted and then for so long sustained the East India Company, were fast disappearing. Unless something were done, the region must moulder into ruin. The court was only too well aware of the financial disaster looming. Before Plassey, the company's trading operations in Bengal had brought a flow of between 500,000 and £1 million a year in specie to London. That flow had almost ceased, and would soon be reversed if affairs in Bengal reached a crisis. In 1769 they did, with a catastrophic famine. By 1772, the once so profitable East India Company could not meet its creditors and had to be rescued by the government. Again, as after the Patna massacre, opium was not responsible for the crisis, but again the future of the opium trade was to be decided by the change of policy which resulted. The government set up an inquiry, and among those who were ready to give evidence were Verelst, the man of integrity, and Boltz, the buccaneer. Boltz's methods had finally led to proceedings being instituted against him by Verelst in Calcutta. And though with the help of barrackroom legal devices on the one hand, and blackmail and forgery on the other, he had been able to delay retribution, he had eventually been deported. But he brought back to London a fortune of close on £1 million, and in London, with characteristic effrontery, he published a 3-volume work on British India, describing what had been happening there, portraying himself as the injured innocent and Verelst, by implication, as the villain. All branches of Indian commerce, he complained, were monopolies of the most cruel and ruinous nature, and so totally corrupted from every species of abuse as to be in the last stages of annihilation. The natives, at the mercy of a few men who divide the spoils of the public among themselves, had looked to Britain for relief in vain. Now they found themselves oppressed beyond conception, so that population and revenue were alike falling. These allegations had the ring of sincerity. Boltz appears to have been one of those consummate scoundrels, commoner than is generally realised, who managed to convince themselves at all time of their total rectitude. His considerations on Indian affairs did not, as he hoped, bring him revenge over those who had been responsible for his deportation. He was to squander his fortune on futile litigation, and had to resume his career as an adventurer, eventually dying in poverty. But at the time, they helped to rouse indignation against the company and against Verelst, who had to go into exile in France to escape the attentions of litigants. And Verelst's defence in his View of the Rise, Progress, and Present State of the British Government of Bengal, though it vindicated his own reputation, was an even more scathing indictment of the company's record in Bengal. The government, which had been trying to escape involvement, was compelled to intervene, and under Lord North's India Act, passed in 1773, a new council of 5 members was set up to rule British India, which included Madras and Bombay, though they were regarded as of minor importance, on behalf of the East India Company. One of them was to be, in effect, Governor-General, though he was to have only the casting vote, and the Court of Directors' choice for the post was Warren Hastings. Warren Hastings. Before Hastings' appointment, the opium monopoly's continued existence had not been formally recognised, and the expectation was that it would cease to exist, in deference both to the British government's avowed aims, as expressed in the India Act, and to Hastings' own feelings. "I abhor monopolies," he claimed, "especially those founded in violence," as he knew opium had been. He had joined the company in 1750, at the age of 18, and although opportunities to make money had not been neglected, his record, compared to most of his colleagues, had been eminently respectable. He had been one of those who had warned Van Sittert of the consequences of the methods employed by Bolt's agents. He had taken the trouble to learn Urdu. He had listened sympathetically to Indian grievances, too sympathetically, Clive had felt, and for a while he had left the company's service in despair at its maladministration. Now that he was back, he longed to bring relief to an exhausted country, and that could only come, he realised, by relieving the inhabitants of the excessive burdens which had been imposed on them by taxation and monopoly. Hastings, though, found himself in the same dilemma as Clive a few years earlier. To provide a just and efficient administration, he must increase the revenue. To put up the land tax or the excise duties would be difficult, in view of the condition of Bengal, and also extremely unpopular. The revenue from opium, by contrast, could be extracted relatively painlessly, as the consumers were foreigners. He knew how profitable the drug could be. In his first year in office, he had sold £7,000 on his private account. Most of the company's servants traded in it, if they could afford to, even the commander-in-chief of the company's army. It would be foolish, Hastings realised, to let so useful a source of revenue slip out of the company's hands, when it could be farmed out to a contractor, as it had been under the Nawab. He suspected, though, that when the other members of the council arrived out from England, they would insist on winding up the opium monopoly, supposedly terminated years before. To protect it, he thought of an ingenious excuse. The standard free trade argument against monopoly was that it restricted production. But was not this, in relation to opium, an argument in monopoly's favour? It may be argued that the increase of any production not necessary to life is not an advantage if some other commodity equally valuable must be given up to make room for it, that it is not a necessary of life but a pernicious article of luxury, which ought not to be permitted but for the purpose of foreign commerce only, and which the wisdom of government should carefully restrain from internal consumption. The first admission that the commodity that the company would be relying on for part of its revenue was a dangerous drug. Hastings went on to make a point better calculated to make an impression on the directors back in Leadenhall Street. If the trade were thrown open, competition would stimulate production, and either the surplus opium would find a market in India, which was undesirable, or the price would fall, which would merely take the profit from those few who now solely possess it, and divide it among as many as may choose to share it. The revenue that otherwise would have come to the company would simply be dissipated among competing firms. The court of directors took the hint. The Patner Group, it was decided, would be disbanded, and the opium monopoly farmed out for the company's benefit to a contractor. Hastings managed, however, to conciliate the group by securing the contract for their former manager, Mir Munhir, and arranging that they would be provided with gratuities in lieu of their advantages of trade from which they interdicted themselves. Mir Munhir consequently found himself in much the same position in relation to the opium cultivators as the Bolts group had been in relation to the Bengal peasants in general. Although he was enjoined not to attempt compulsion, the monopoly powers he had been granted enabled him to dictate to the ryots, as the Bengal peasants were known, what price they should receive for their opium. If they were reluctant to grow poppy, he had an inducement for them. They would be advanced sufficient money to buy seed and hire the labour necessary to prepare the land. But as soon as they had accepted the advance, they found they were in Munhir's debt, liable to be prosecuted if they did not carry out his instructions, and evicted. Soon, angry complaints of oppression were coming in from the poppy-growing regions. These were followed by complaints from the Chinese smokers, now among the company's best customers, about the decline in the quality of the opium. The ryots, in desperation, had been adulterating the drug. It was just the opportunity that Philip Francis, who had come out to be one of the members of the council, was hoping for. He was determined to discredit Hastings, and as he enjoyed the support of two other council members, it looked as if his proposal, that the opium monopoly should be wound up, would be accepted. But Hastings proved too clever for him. To Francis's chagrin, his two hitherto faithful backers let themselves be persuaded that opium provided too valuable a source of revenue to lose. He continued to assail the monopoly. The following year he warned the directors in London that Bihar, the main opium-growing area, could only be rescued from its condition of universal poverty and depopulation by throwing open the trade. Again, Hastings outmaneuvered him by awarding the opium contract to Francis's friend John Mackenzie, and for a 3-year period, ostensibly to give the contractor a better opportunity to come to mutually agreed terms with the cultivators. How Mackenzie availed himself of the opportunity was to be the subject of an outraged remonstrance in 1777, complaining that on a large tract of land where corn was growing, which would have been ready for harvesting in a month's time, the corn had suddenly been cut down in order that the land might be prepared for the immediate cultivation of poppy. But Francis had been silenced. Mackenzie was left to enjoy the benefits of the contract for the full term, with a bonus year at the end of it, untroubled except by murmurings from some of the London directors, who suspected that the deal might be designed, as so many Calcutta transactions were, to cream off the profits in India, rather than allow them through to Leadenhall Street. These suspicions were soon confirmed. By 1780, Hastings' enemies had been scattered, and his position in India appeared secure. But he had to be careful to sustain his Leadenhall Street supporters now that Francis was back in London plotting revenge. And the most influential of them, the Irish wheeler-dealer Lawrence Sullivan, chairman of the Court of Directors, the uncrowned king of Leadenhall Street, was in dire financial trouble, not for the first time. He sent out his son Stephen to India, with a letter suggesting that Hastings might like to put him on the council, but adding that profit more than station must of necessity be our object. By your affectionate friendship, much more may be done for him out of council, and how true it is that much is wanted. Always loyal to his friends, Hastings rallied to Lawrence's support. A new opium contract was due, and as Mackenzie had not been able to provide as much opium as had been hoped, Hastings had an excuse to suggest that some of the government's restrictions on the contractor's freedom of action had been excessive, and that he was therefore proposing to modify the contract's terms. Superintendence of the process of opium manufacture, which had been introduced to try to combat adulteration, had proved irksome. It would be abandoned. The injunction that the ryots must not be coerced into growing poppy would be dropped. Instead, The requirement would simply be that the opium was to be procured lawfully and reasonably, which would afford little protection to the riots. It had recently been laid down that the use of force on behalf of the company, where the company deemed it necessary, was justified by the customs of the country. These changes, Hastings admitted, would make it possible for the contractor to use arbitrary and tyrannical methods. The contract, therefore, could not be given to the man who offered to supply opium to the company at the lowest price. Hastings would himself select a suitable recipient. His choice was the newly arrived Stephen Sullivan. Sullivan, or his father, could not afford to await the new contract's full benefit. He promptly sold it for £20,000, and the purchaser was able to resell it for £20,000 more. These transactions revealed that opium had become considerably more profitable than anybody had realised, except presumably Mackenzie, who for 4 years had enjoyed the profits. Either Stephen Sullivan's advisers must have grossly underestimated the sum he could obtain by selling the contract, or they had deliberately exploited his ignorance to deceive him. The next time the contract came up, therefore, the company would be in a position to appropriate the £40,000 difference. Added to the £60,000 profit which it was making on its sales, this would make opium an extremely lucrative source of revenue. Just how dependent the company already was on that source was demonstrated in the winter of 1780, when war with the Dutch led to the virtual suspension of trade with the East Indies. Thousands of pounds worth of stocks of the company's opium began to build up in its Calcutta warehouses, and file revenue from the trade was severely curtailed. Losses in the company's fleet from enemy action, too, were heavy. Only 4 out of 13 ships which were engaged in the China trade managed to reach Canton, and 2/3 of the company's purchases of tea awaiting them there could not be shipped, but they still had to be paid for. Hastings was compelled to borrow the money at a high rate of interest and to find some way to pay it back as soon as possible. It happened that in 1779, one of the country ships had risked taking a consignment of the drug not just to Macau, where it was ordinarily unloaded, but up the river to Huangpu, the port of Canton. Why should the company not try the same gamble on its own account? When it was put to him, Hastings approved of the plan. 2 ships were fitted out and armed, with instructions to sell their cargo of opium wherever they could, but if necessary, to bring it to Huangpu and instruct the company's supercargoes to sell it there. Hastings was aware what this decision might involve. A reminder had been issued not long before by the Calcutta Council that the import of opium into China was prohibited, under the severest penalties, not only loss of life to the guilty person, but extirpation of his family and the confiscation of the ship or vessel that imports it, which is immediately burnt. We therefore beg you will positively forbid any of our commanders or others receiving it sending it on board for this place. Should it happen to be discovered, it may be of the utmost consequence to our trade here, and not only to our trade, but to our persons. We are here liable to answer for the misdemeanours of any persons who may come as passengers on our ships. Also, the security merchant of the ship is answerable for the duties on any goods they may bring. Opium brought by them may equally involve us in difficulties, as if brought by the commanders or any officer belonging to the ships. Nonsuch and Betsy, Hastings decided, must not be reported as bearing a cargo of opium, that being a contraband trade. They were to pretend to be warships visiting Canton. Betsy was lost, but Nonsuch managed to get through to Macau, sailing under French and Spanish colours, with her cargo of £200,000 of opium. The company's supercargoes were horrified. Hastings had forgotten, or chosen to ignore, that there was also an imperial ban on armed foreign ships entering the Canton River. His instructions were too explicit to be repudiated. Nonsuch had to be restored to the semblance of a merchantman before proceeding to Huangpu, where her cargo was furtively unloaded. The alarm of the supercargoes was understandable. Since 1759, Canton had been the only port through which trade with China was permitted. 12 years later, through judicious use of bribery authorized by the company for the purpose, they had secured what they regarded as a vital concession, the right to reside there. Irksome restrictions were imposed. They could stay only in the winter, the trading season. They had to live in one of the factories, warehouses, part of which were converted into living quarters, in a small ghetto on the river. Their movements outside it were severely curtailed, and they were not allowed to bring their wives with them. But they appreciated the reason. "There is cause for apprehension," the emperor had warned in 1717, "lest China may be endangered by collision with the various nations of the West, who come hither from beyond the seas." And his successors, poorly informed though they were about what went on in the rest of the world, were well aware how his foreboding had been justified by the course of events in other Eastern countries, including...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.